For those who are new here, we've been in the middle of talking about financial hope. What is your game plan? And the heart behind the series is actually to give hope to every single one of us, regardless of where you may be financially today. And I think for many of us, finances are a huge pressure. They're so important to us. I believe they're also important to God. Over 2,350 scriptures talk around the subject of money. And my heart is that every one of us would have a jubilee faith, a jubilee season. Jubilee comes from the Old Testament, where the Israelites, the children of Israel, every 50 years their debts were cancelled and they could start over again. And I can imagine for most of us, if you had APSA or F&B phoning you tomorrow morning and said, you know what, we're in the Christmas spirit and we just really feel sorry for you and feeling great compassion. And they said, listen, all the debts, credit card, you name it, bond, it's all released. Just experience a jubilee. Well, there would be great rejoicing. And I reckon most of us would say, listen, the patterns that caused us to get into debt in the first place, we're going to change those patterns because we want to stay out of it. It's not a nice place to be in. So last week we spoke around debt deliverance, and you can get that from our website. Download it for free just to bless you. There was a survey done on people who were struggling financially, and they found this, that 75% of the people that were struggling financially did not prepare or follow a budget, 75% of them. And so often, if we're honest about this, that we are overspending, we're living beyond our means, we're getting more and more into debt, one of the reasons why is because we don't have a spending plan. Spending plan. Can I just pause that? Just to go back to the Jubilee, I'm not suggesting that this month you're going to be totally set free of all your debts. It's going to take time. But my heart is, and I believe the Lord's heart, is that there would be a faith and a hope in you to see your debts ultimately cancelled and removed. But it's going to require us partnering with the Lord. And even as I was driving here this morning, I really sense just the love, the tenderness, the compassion of Jesus saying, Chris, I really want to help them. I really want to help you, Chris, Lisa. That the Lord really wants to step into whatever mess we may be in this morning, whether it's finances or whatever, but the Lord wants to step in and intervene and help every one of us. And all we're going to do is just have a humble, open heart and say, God, please come. Help us. You know we're overspending when our credit cards are maxed out, when we can only pay the credit card minimums, when your debt exceeds your monthly income, when you splurge on fun stuff but neglect the important bills and fixed expenses. You know you're overspending when your expenses rise with your income, and that there's more in your closet than there is in your bank account. Now, I am not an economist. I'm not the son of an economist. I am a pastor, and I sometimes find it quite amusing that I get to talk on some of these subjects, because I know many of you far more educated than me, and you could teach me so many things in all of us here. But it's the Word of God, and that's our final authority that we stand on this morning. In the first part of the series, we spoke about how to live like a king, a wise king. And we looked at King Hezekiah, who was a wise king, and how he rebuilt the broken walls in the city. And in the same way that the Lord wants us to rebuild our financial walls for protection, and that will help us live by a basic biblical financial plan that will bring blessing to us, and that some of the barriers in that wall, or building that wall, speaks of removing debt. And we spoke about the debt snowball. We've spoken about stewardship, and that the Lord owns everything and He's calling us to be wise managers of what He's given us. We're also talking about today the whole idea of putting together a budget so that everything that comes in goes out on purpose with a plan, and also the important subject of building savings over time. It was on Tuesday night that we had a wonderful Australian guy, Nick McKay, and his wonderful wife, Dawn Faith, and Dawn helps lead in praise and worship, and he was our MC, and he was just phenomenal. And he also asked us some of the questions, and we, for a moment in the show, we felt like we were in the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Who wants to be a millionaire? And I reckon most of us would love to be a millionaire. And do we know in the show that you get this opportunity when you don't know what to do next, that what you can do is you can phone a friend. And I've titled today's message, Your Buddy, Your Budget. Your Buddy, Your Budget. And I reckon that when we look at a budget, it's a healthy boundary, a healthy fence that protects or helps us avoid unnecessary pain. Because many of us in this room know the pain of finances. And I believe a good boundary, a good budget, what it does is it protects us from going into wrong places like too much stress, anxiety, and debt, and overspending, and all those different things. And so what we want to do is just look at some of the biblical basics of budgeting and some practical financial tips to get your budget in line with your income. What is a budget? A budget simply is a written spending plan for your money that includes giving, saving, and spending. And it is critical to our financial freedom, critical to our financial freedom. And I know that a church this size, we have there's different personalities. And you get your great creatives, and when it comes to following a budget, might be quite difficult. But I want to encourage you, regardless of our personality, let's just see this as something the Lord is saying. This is one practical tool to help us finding financial peace, financial freedom. And so there's nothing more powerful than planning your spending before the money shows up, before the month begins. Nothing more powerful. And creating a spending plan, what it's doing is it's helping you and me determine in advance if you'll have enough money to do the things that you need to do or would like to do. And so it's simply balancing your expenses with your income and then also beginning to enjoy your income. We looked at some of the roots that fuel us into debt or lead us into debt. And sometimes it's discontentment and comparison and not having gratitude. And sometimes we've got to just be grateful for what we're getting right now. And let's be as wise as we can be with the help of God in living in reality. Give it, and budgets give us perspective, but also it's very empowering at the beginning of the month when you know, okay, this is where I'm sending my money. Why is it biblically important to have a budget in the first place? Well, Proverbs chapter 27, verse 23 and 24 says, "Be diligent to know the state of your flocks and attend to your herds. For riches are not forever, nor does a crown endure to all generations." And so obviously this is speaking to an agrarian culture at that time, and they lived on livestock and herds and produce crops. And here the Lord is saying, he's saying, listen, I'm wanting you to give careful attention to what you have, what comes in and goes out. This is speaking in context of livestock and produce. But in the same way, we could put money there, our rands, our budget. And that the Lord is saying, listen, I'm wanting you to give careful attention to what's coming in and going out. I'm wanting you to know the state of your financial status. Jesus said it this way in Luke chapter 14, verse 28. He said, "For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, 'This man began to build and was not able to finish.'" And so what is Jesus here saying? Yes, he's speaking, it's a parable, a spiritual truth, but also talking about the importance of having a plan in place. We all need a plan. If we fail to plan, we plan to fail. And so it's a good thing to have a plan. And so here Jesus is saying, listen, if you're going to build the tower and you don't have a plan to finish it, if you don't finish it, people are going to begin to mock you and undermine you and criticize you. And in the same way, imagine you're spending your money and you run out of money before the end of the month, before you get your next paycheck, and people are going to mock you. And so it's biblical to put a plan in place and submit it to the Lord. Maybe someone here might be saying, well, Chris, yeah, Jesus speaking about a tower or a house, I barely receive any income, and so it doesn't apply to me. Listen to what Jesus says. Regardless of what we receive, Luke 16, verse 10 and 11, one who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much. And one who's dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And so the point is if that you've been given a very little, here God wants us to understand that we still have a responsibility over our little to manage it, and then God can begin to entrust us with more. If we're going to be unfaithful in the little, then how can we expect to be entrusted with more? And so here's a principle for all of us. Let's be faithful, wise stewards over the little or much that we have been given. And I love what the scripture also said, where Jesus says, if you're going to handle worldly wealth wisely and faithfully, he's also going to entrust to you the true riches, which I also believe speaks of influence. I believe it speaks of anointing. I believe it speaks of peace and so many of the other spiritual blessings that come by following Jesus Christ. I was chatting to Lee this morning, and I said, you know, Lee, I suppose it comes down to us valuing every cent, doesn't it? Valuing one rand, how often it is for us just to not consider or respect one rand or 1 cent. And I believe it comes to that place where we begin to be faithful in the little. Listen to what Proverbs chapter 21, verse 5 says. Quite a few scriptures today. Plan carefully and you will have enough. Plan carefully and you will have enough. If you act too quickly, you will never have enough. Now, one of the things so often we believe is that financial freedom is based on how much we make. And that is a myth. So often we think, well, if I just have a little bit more, I'll be fine. I'll be financially free. And the truth is, if we can't live on what we're receiving right now, we won't then. Why? Because I love how Rick Warren says it, our yearnings exceed our earnings. So often our yearnings exceed our earnings. And so we're always going to want more than we make. And so financial freedom is not based on how much you make, but rather based on how much you spend. And so it's not by just making more. Yes, that's a great help, but actually it comes down to planning carefully what you have already so that you will have enough. And so all you got to do is bring your spending in line with your income. That's where God wants to help us. If we spend less, you don't have to make more, even though you will make more as you and I are being wise stewards of what we already have. But it's all about the spending. If you plan carefully, you will have enough. The scripture also says, if you act too quickly, you'll never have enough. How many of you ever gone to the shops and bought something that you didn't plan to buy? Okay, so there is a spirit of truth. There's a bit of spirit of dishonesty in there and there. Okay, no, cool. We'll pray for that at communion. We're having communion a little later. We can act so quickly, and this is called impulse buying. So we go to the shop and we see something really, really nice. It wasn't on our agenda, wasn't on our list, and we didn't plan to buy it. It wasn't in the budget, and we go for it. We make an impulsive decision, and we act too quickly. And it's only afterwards we think, you know, did I really, really need that? Now, I don't know about you, but I've never gone into Four Ways Mall or Sandton Shopping Center and seen this ad saying, listen, I want you to think about this decision you're about to make right now. I want you to think about this decision for at least the next 6 months. Go and see if you can add it in your budget, and we suggest you put it in your budget, and then when you've got the cash, please come through and purchase it. That happens every single week. Never. But advertising, it's all about that impulsive thing, that instant gratification. Let's get it now. And so you see something looks cool and hip, and you think, I've got to have it. And yet 5 minutes before you made the decision, you realize I didn't really need it, but in that moment, the advertising lured us. And that's what advertising does. Obviously, it does what the Bible's encouraging us to be careful of. Don't act too quickly. Watch the impulsive spending, buying. What does that do? The overspending, it leads us to more debt, which brings more pressure in our lives. And so if we act too quickly, the Bible says you will not have enough. Now this scripture, guys, is a kicker, this next one. I didn't say it, okay? Proverbs 21 verse 20 says, stupid people spend their money as fast as they get it. It's the end of the sermon. Let's pray and let's go home. Now, I'll tell you, I've been a stupid person. I know what the scripture means, and I believe it's also a mark of immaturity. I mean, it's something we've all got to grow in, and we are many times acting too quickly, impulsive, and this is in one sense God's IQ test, how smart are you? And saying an unwise person, their money burns a hole through their pocket, and they're not prepared to exercise self-control, not prepared to hold on it, that money, for a few months or even a year. Why? Because I've got to spend it now. And this is why it's so important for us to have a financial plan for our freedom. How do we break the habit of overspending and impulse buying? Well, one of them is budget. It's your buddy, your budget. And it spells relief. That's budget. And so it's telling your money where you want it to go instead of wondering where it went. Planning your spending. And I believe this. I believe there's a grace and a blessing on any person that humbles themselves in this and says, Lord, please help me create a budget and also live by one. And so that we're managing his resources wisely. Helpful tips in budgeting. If you've been tracking expenses, a few weeks ago we loaded a brochure, Excel document on our website just to help you so that you can start tracking expenses. It takes a little bit of time on this, but you just can see some of the things you thought, I wasn't spending that much, or I'm spending too much on food, or I'm spending too much on this and that. It's important that you start tracking your expenses, notice that you're overspending in certain areas, and in there to not be afraid to trim the budget, and also don't stress yourself out. Give yourself time. There's some say it takes about 3 months to properly formulate a workable budget. So be patient with yourself, but start the process. Some of you could do it overnight. Just to be very practical, so I believe the Word of God is also very practical in our lives. If things are tight right now, you can do some practical things. You could cancel your DSTV. You could make a decision, we're not going to eat out that much. We're going to be wise on what we buy. We're going to stop buying the Versace and Gucci and all the branded clothes and the goods. Whenever you shop, there's going to be an opportunity to substitute some expensive goods for inexpensive goods. And so be aware of that. That'll also fill the need, but help you in the area of your finances. So be on the lookout for cheaper options. Let's value the one rand. Let's value the one rand. Buy no-name brands. For some of us, it might be very difficult to do that, but even if it's for that season or whatever it is, but get into that place. Buy generic medication. If you're allowed to, in certain scripts that you get, take advantage of specials. If you know that you're going to need a certain product for the next 30 days, sometimes it clicks and Dischem and Pick and Pay and Checkers, sometimes it's 3 for 2, be wise on that and be on the lookout for those specials. Use reward cards. I've loved it when I've times gone to Clicks or Dischem and here all of a sudden I hear, hey, listen, do you want your cash back right now? There's $50 or $100. It's a phenomenal, phenomenal feeling. Also, when your cell phone contract, don't just assume that as it's reached a year or 2 years and that you're just going to renew it, shop around. Begin looking at the data options and you can save yourself quite a bit just on that. Lisa herself recently, just with the kids, looking at a new contract, was able to get a lot more data for Michael and Kayla. As you know, Michael's now just finished matric and Kayla in varsity. And so I was going to say a joke, then it's not going to work. So just let me get out of that one quickly. When it comes to buying a car, nothing wrong with buying a new car, but they do say, listen, consider, you don't always have to buy a new car. Consider buying a car that's maybe 3 years old. They say it's more profitable to buy a car that's 3 years old. Why? Because it's already done most of its depreciation. So consider that. Hey, you don't always need the latest gadget or latest phone. The phone often we have is quite sufficient. Consider taking lunch to work. Maybe for those who love your Seattle coffee shop fixes in the morning, why don't you consider taking coffee on the way to work? There's just very practical things that we can do. Another important point is this, is a great way to save money is start using cash rather than credit. Research shows the following. One is the more credit cards you have in your wallet, the larger the purchases you will make. That's what research has shown. I reckon maybe it's psychological. We think because I've got a few credit cards in my wallet, it makes me just feel wealthier. Maybe that's what it's the message there. But that's what they say. More credit cards in your wallet, the larger the purchases the person makes. A second point on based on research is when spending with a credit card, you tend to purchase quicker and forget quickly what we have spent. It's something about just, it's a quick swipe. You forget about it. You don't necessarily see the money out of your account the next month. It's only at the end of the month, and we don't see the money disappear. Online purchases make it that much, much quicker. But when it comes to cash, which is quite interesting, when spending with cash, when you're watching your hard-earned cash disappear as you give it to the teller, it's a lot harder to let it go. It's almost when you're holding that 100 Rand note, the buffalo on the back of the 100 Rand note's eyes begin to bulge. You're holding that note so hard. But when it's a credit card, it's just quick swipe and we forget about it. But when it's cash, when you're letting that 100 Rand go, you feel that I just lost the buffalo. So when you use cash, it'll lower the amount to spend. Third point around this research, credit cards remove the pain of purchasing. And so you don't feel the pain of buying. You don't feel the pain of purchasing. When you're using your cash, you do. And so it's in one sense, credit cards are like this anesthetic. When you're going through the operation, hey, it doesn't feel, it's quite painless. It's only later that you start feeling the pain. And then on average, people pay 12 to 18% more when using credit cards versus cash. 12 to 18% more when using credit cards versus cash. This was an interesting thing I found recently off Financial Hope. McDonald's changed their whole system when it came to credit cards. In 2002, the way I understand it, is they did not take credit cards. They did not take credit cards because of the fee McDonald's would have to pay for someone, a customer paying every time they purchased a meal. They would have to pay the fee, and then they'd also have to pay an additional fee for installing the credit card machines in all their stores. But they did a study, and they found that someone using a credit card was likely to pay $7 on a burger over someone paying in cash $4.50. And so they immediately put the credit card machines, increased their revenue because they knew it would increase their overall income. Aware of just how people avoid the pain of purchasing when they use credit cards. Maybe what we've got to do for some of us, we've got to perform some plastic surgery and maybe cut up the credit card or maybe shred it or maybe hide it somewhere in the house. I don't know. But maybe some of us say, well, listen, I get 1% cash back. What we've got to compare that to is, well, maybe you might be getting the cash back, but hey, listen, if you consider that every month you're having to pay an additional 12 to 18% interest. Now, I do know that there's some people that are very, very disciplined when it comes to their credit card. They get the rewards and the cash back, but what they do is they settle whatever they spent on the credit card that month. If you've got that discipline, cool. If you don't, maybe you've got to do what this one lady did. She put a credit card in a bowl of water and then put it in the freezer. And so every time she wanted to purchase something, she would literally have to wait for the water to defrost. Now, for those you've got a problem in this area, if you thought this, yeah, but I'll just quickly microwave it, then you've got a major problem and then you need some prayer. So just think having no credit card debt means paying no minimum payments, no interest rates and all those things. And so let's try and take the middleman out of it. 18%. whatever it is, let's get to debit cards and cash. I know some of you use the envelope system, the cash system, for certain budget categories that you know trip you up. And so if you're aware that, listen, I'm always overspending on food or always overspending on the fun stuff, maybe you want to cash out that category and say, okay, listen, for food, this is what I'm going to spend. This is the cash I'm going to use. And once that's over, it's over. Or this fun category, whatever it is, once it's the cash runs out, it stops spending. So it becomes a great accountability partner. Create a budget. And so all it is asking yourself, well, what do I earn? And what do I owe? And what are my expenses? And on this Excel document that we have on the website, it's there. It goes through the different categories from giving to housing to children expenses, personal, recreation, transportation, all those areas. And you can modify it as you want to. But the important thing is just to create a simple plan and listing where you want the money to go so that you can also enjoy your income. And so we've got the categories, it's income, expenses, and then you're going to find out when you set your budget, you may be paying out more than what you're making. And so be patient with yourself, and you might have to trim and revise until such time as your budget balances. Now, finally, just want to share 7 simple principles when you're preparing your budget to do a heart check as you're submitting this plan to the Lord who wants to help you and me. The first is, am I putting God first? This is an important part for us as followers of Christ. We are agents, citizens of his kingdom, children of his kingdom, and that Jesus says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 and 10 says, honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. I believe if we're not putting God first, then everything's out of alignment when it comes to the area of our finances. And so there are many scriptures to support that, but you start where you can. And I really believe it's such an important principle. Say, God, I'm honoring you first. Secondly, do I have an eternal perspective? Do I have an eternal perspective? Am I recognizing that God is wanting me to be a faithful, wise steward of all he's given me? My money, my talents, the time, all these different areas, and that also when I am with the Lord face to face, apart from just being in worship of him, God's also going to ask us the question, what did you do with what I gave you? And I believe that for all of us, we want to have the heart attitude and say, listen, Lord, this is what I did. Whatever you gave me, Lord, I was a wise, faithful steward over those areas, including the budget. And the Bible talks about that he's going to reward. He's going to reward us. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6 says, godliness with contentment is great gain. Another translation says, great wealth. For we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. And so are you content with what God has given you, or are you always striving for more? You're always restless, always restless. We need to find our rest in God and also being grateful for what we have. We can grow it as we are faithful stewards of what he's given us. Remember this, guys, 100 years from now, your relationship with God is what's going to really matter. And I believe also the people that we've influenced for his kingdom. Third question to ask ourselves, do I hear and obey? Are we obeying God's word? Listen to what Luke 11 verse 28 says, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Are we submitting ourselves to God's word? Even in terms of this series, challenging many of us, encouraging us to say, God, this is what your word says. Lord, I'm not going to have the attitude anymore that it's, well, it's mine and I can just do whatever it wants. Lord, you're watching me and you're here to help me. You really want me to experience financial freedom and peace. And I really believe therein lies a stronghold that sometimes trips us up. We just kind of think, it's mine, I've worked hard for it, and I'm going to do whatever I want with it. I believe we've got to watch for that attitude, whereas we've got to have the wise attitude saying, God, you're the owner of it all. You want to help me in this. He's your key financial provider and advisor who has your best interest at heart. Amen? So look to God, ask him for wisdom, and obey him. Let's go to point 4. Am I working hard and managing well to take care of my household? 1 Timothy 5 verse 8 says this, but if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. And so we have a biblical duty to use our gifts and our talents and our finances and our time to provide for those that we love. And I understand that some of us go through difficult circumstances, unemployment, retrenchment, there's a whole discussion around that. However, for those who are receiving an income, to do what you can to be wise stewards, to provide for your family. Remember, God is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. He is the source. He is our provider, and He is calling us to manage His provision. Even though He's given you the air and the gifts and the intellect to create wealth, look at Deuteronomy 8 verse 18 says, "And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you power to get wealth, that He may establish His covenant which He swore to your fathers as it is this day." And so without God, we are nothing. And the word Lord, Jesus is our Lord, means owner. He's the owner of it all. And when we submit to Him and His ways, we see the fruit and blessing. Fifth question to ask ourselves when we're preparing a budget: do I have a plan to remove debt? Listen to what Proverbs 22 verse 26 and 27 says. Do not be one who shakes hands in pledge or puts up security for debts. If you lack the means to pay, your very bed will be snatched from under you. In other words, if you've purchased your furniture, purchased your bed, and you're not able to repay, repossession is possible. And maybe there's some people that have gone through the pain and the pressure of just that. And it's saying that someone can literally take your bed away from you. And that's a physical thing. But I believe there's a spiritual, emotional side to the scripture. Think about the most peaceful place that you should have is your bedroom, is your bed. Place where you can just rest from a hectic day, refresh, be restored for the next day. And here the Bible knows, is saying, listen, if we're going to live a lifestyle of debt, your own bed can be snatched away. But I wonder how many of us have lost sleep as a result of the pressure and the burden of debt. And so I believe the Lord wants to help us in that. So let's have a plan to get rid of the debt. And last week we spoke about the debt snowball, and that's all available on video, a great tool to help us all. Then do you have a plan to save? Do you have a plan to save? Proverbs 21 verse 20 says, "In the house of the wise are stores of choice food and oil, but a foolish man devours all he has." And I believe that the Lord wants us to build margin in life. The more margin we have, often the more financial peace we have. Yes, our security comes from the Lord and Him as our provider. But I tell you, we can have great margin when we're learning to save. And next week as we land the series, we're going to in and around that, and some beautiful principles from God's word to encourage us. And then finally, do I guard my heart? Do I guard my heart? Proverbs 4:23 says, "Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life." So we got to guard our heart. What is getting in our heart? What's influencing us? Is greed and selfishness and just the desire for the deceitfulness of riches? That's what's driving us. That's what we're striving for. Jesus spoke about the parable of the sowers and how a sower goes out and he's sowing seed in different soils. And speaking of good soil, rich soil that produced a 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold return. And then he talks about the stony soil and the hard soil and the thorny soil. And this just speaks of different attitudes of our hearts. And this can be people who love the Lord, sincere before the Lord. But this represents the attitude condition of a heart. And in verse 18 and 19, Mark chapter 4, it says, "Now these are the ones sown among thorns. They're the ones who hear the word, and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desires for other things entering in choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful." And so this is something we've all got to look in the mirror and say, "Lord, help me guard my heart from the deceitfulness of riches, always desiring the things of the world. This is what I'm always striving for. That's what's going to make me valuable. My value and my self-worth is determined by my net worth." And we've looked at that your value comes from relationship with Jesus Christ. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 9 and 10 says, "But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money," not money, but "for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from their faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. And so once again, we got to ask ourselves, am I guarding my heart from the desires of riches, chasing after wealth? Now, I'll say this. There are wealthy people in this church who love the Lord, wealthy people across the world who love God, and they understand the deceitfulness of riches, and they've put God first, and they're following God in the area of their finances and being wise. And so it's not meaning every rich person. But I am going to say this. In 1 Timothy 6, it commands those who are rich. It says this. Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. And so here God is saying, listen, things for us to enjoy. He wants us to enjoy what we have, to be grateful for what we have, but also recognize that our trust cannot come in uncertain riches. That is a recipe for disaster. We've got to have our trust in Jesus and Jesus alone. But he's also calling us to be a generous people, a wise people, but also generous people. Now, it's quite interesting when you've got an opportunity, go to a website called globalrichlist.com, globalrichlist.com, just to see how wealthy you are compared to the rest of the world. And all you do is just type in your annual income, and they have all different currencies there as well as South African rands. We at the very bottom, so we'll have to speak to these guys about this. But realize how rich you are. And it's said that if you make over 5,000 rand a month, you're in the top 15% of the richest people in the world. If you earn over 10,000 rand a month, you are in the top 2.8% richest people in the world. Some of you can just let that sink in. Some of you are always saying, well, it's Bill Gates and it's Buffett and all the other blokes. But hey, according to this, you're in the 2.8% richest people in the world if you're earning more than 10,000 rand a month. We've spoken about our beliefs, how they lead to behaviors, how they lead to outcomes. And sometimes the outcomes are not good outcomes. We're not liking the pressure of the debt and we're wanting to change it. And so often we try and change the behaviors, but after 21 days, if we haven't changed our beliefs, we just continue doing the wrong behaviors. And so what we're going to do is allow the Word of God to begin to renew us and change us. We're going to change our beliefs and have a revelation of where God is looking at us and the way he's looking at our resources and how he wants to intervene and help us. And so the scripture in Romans 12 says, do not copy the behavior or customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you'll learn to know what God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. And there you can see the outcomes. We want a good and pleasing outcome for every one of us, but it's going to require us getting back to the Word of God. And maybe some of you are just going to need to go back in through the notes of this series and just saying, Lord, I'm going to look into your mirror. Even that heart check that we've just gone through. Lord, let your word be a mirror. Lord, I need to change my mind because, Lord, I realize you want your will to be established in my life on earth as it is in heaven. And it's a good, pleasing, and perfect will. Amen. Can we just bow our heads in prayer before we go into communion? Father, you're the creator of the universe. You're almighty and you're all-knowing. And Lord, you know everything about us. Father, the fact that you can keep billions and billions of stars in the various galaxies all steady just tells us, Lord, how you know what you're doing. Lord, that you know how many stars are in the sky. Lord, that you know, Lord, how many hairs we have on our head. Lord, that you know us each by name. And God, that we can rest on you, that we can depend on you, that God, you are indeed our creator, that you are our Father, that loves us, and wants to help us, and you give us your word to give us faith and to comfort us and console us and also to lead us into righteousness. Lord, I pray for faith to rise on the inside of every single one of us. Lord, also just a fresh surrender, that we would surrender our hearts to you. And Lord, we know money's important, but Lord, you're far more important than it. But Lord, you're wanting to give us a strategy, a plan, Lord, to get us through. And Lord, even like the children of Israel, Lord, that there was supernatural, miraculous provision. Lord, that, Lord, you want to speak to some people here today. Lord, as we just do our part, Lord, and just follow you. Lord, that you want to show yourself strong on behalf of us. And Lord, perform miracles in lives here today. Lord, where hearts have become so dim and discouraged just a result of the financial pressures, Lord, I pray that you'd bring light into their hearts, hope into hearts. Lord, that the entrance of your word gives light and, Lord, gives hope. And so, God, I thank you for fresh hope and for faith to rise on the inside of each one of us to see yourself, Lord, ruling and reigning in this area. Lord, we give you our lives afresh. Lord, we give you our finances. We say, Jesus, rule and reign. Jesus, you are the great, awesome King. And we invite you, Lord, to establish your rulership, your kingdom, your will in our lives. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Lord, as we just set our hearts, prepare our hearts, Lord, just to celebrate the most pivotal moment in history. Jesus, when you came down, Emmanuel, God with us, came down, Lord, to walk amongst human beings, Lord, to take on our sin, living a sinless life, to become the sinless sacrifice for us so that we can, Lord, be reconciled with the Father for all eternity. The greatest need in every human being is to be reconciled with God, to know the love of God in Jesus Christ. And so, God, right now we thank you for this moment, Lord, where we can just reflect, Lord, on our great salvation, that money cannot buy our salvation. Lord, our good works could not buy our salvation, but Lord, it cost you your blood. Lord, it cost you a price, and Lord, it was the price of your life. So Lord, that we can find forgiveness and in right standing with you. And maybe there's someone here, just before we sing the song, you don't know Jesus. You've never begun a new life in Jesus. Or maybe you made a decision a long time ago and you've drifted like the prodigal son or daughter, and you know that you need to come home and rededicate your life to him. All I ask is that you would just simply pray this prayer. Just say, dear Jesus, I call on you. Jesus, I need you. Thank you for dying for me. You rose again, proving that you are God. Jesus, I invite you to rule and reign in me. I open the door of my heart and I say, come in, be my Savior, be my Lord, take control of my life and make me into the person you've created me to be, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Just as we were singing that beautiful song, Jesus, Jesus, how we trust you. Some of us are trying to trust in ourselves, trying to trust in someone else. I think this is a moment where we've just got to say, no, Lord, I put my full trust in you. It's not by might nor by power, but by the Spirit. This is a moment where we look at what Jesus has done for every one of us, satisfying our deepest need for love and acceptance and belonging, in reconciling us to the Lord through his blood and his life. And this is a moment where we can fully, firstly, just appreciate and just worship just who he is and how he's committed to every one of us. He not only saves us, but he keeps us, sustains us, and strengthens us through all the different struggles and seasons. But this is a moment where we put our full dependence on him, remind ourselves that we're going to depend on him for everything. Jesus said that we shall live not by just bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And his blood and his body is what gives us forgiveness and gives us access into his throne room of grace 24/7, where you find help in your time of need.
Who are you trusting this morning? Who are you going to trust tomorrow? There's a rest that God wants to bring to us. Not a striving, not a restlessness, but a peace and a rest as we just trust in Him and just follow Him. And so Jesus, we thank You for Your body that was broken for us so that we could find healing and wholeness. Lord, we're all fractured in different ways. We have brokenness, Lord, just as a result of sin in this fallen world. But Lord, You come to resurrect. You've come to bring refreshing and renewal. And just before we partake, just a moment between you and the Lord, just examine your own heart and just maybe there's something you've got to put right. Maybe there's someone you've got to forgive. Maybe something just to correct in your own heart where you've just allowed the stress of circumstance and you've forgotten that He's there in the boat with you and He's going to get you to the other side, whatever it is. Jesus, You were hurt for us so that we could receive healing. We thank You for Your body that represents, Lord, this bread that represents Your body, broken, but Lord, also resurrected. We partake depending on You as the bread of our life. Let's partake. Just believe the Lord's healing some people here. In the ear of your own soul. It says you're looking to Him, the great physician, healing bodies, healing minds. We thank You, Jesus, for the cup of the new covenant. Lord, that this is an everlasting covenant. Lord, that speaks of our forgiveness, of our redemption, that speaks of our eternal connection, relationship with You. Lord, that nothing can separate us from Your love because of You and Your blood. Thank You, Lord, for a fresh cleansing on us personally and as a body in Jesus' name. Precious Jesus, we love You. We worship You. We need You. You're our God, our Redeemer. You, Jehovah Shalom, the Lord, our peace. You're the banner of our lives and Your banner is love over us. Lord, I just pray for Your blessing, Your protection, Lord, on everyone here. Lord, that they know, Lord, how special they are to You. Lord, we worship You and thank You. And Lord, we thank You that You'd be the after speaker today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.